Hi, I'm Dr. Ken Leistner. I'm talking to you from the garage gym in Valley Stream that houses my equipment and houses the fellows that I train. I'd like to give good regards and let me say this to the viewers of Powerlifter Video. It's good to be back. Since selling the Iron Island Gym in October of 1998, I haven't had too much affiliation with the sport of powerlifting, but I'm glad that Ned Lowe asked me to say a few words, and I hope that you can benefit from it. I've been in the sport many, many years. It's been over 30 years. It's been almost 35 years, in fact, of competition, coaching, and training. I've been lifting weights for 41 years, and in that time, I've learned a number of things that I think can benefit the typical lifter, the average lifter. Most of us are not Ed Cohn, Mike Bridges, or Pat Casey, some of the greats that I've seen from the mid-60s on to today. Most of us can benefit from any type of aggressive and consistent training. However, the greats are the greats. That's why they're the greats. They have features, they have genetic abilities, they have something mentally and psychologically that the average person doesn't have. Ed Cohn is a typical example, is a guy who will never, ever be rivaled. He's a guy who has got it and has proven it. If you follow Ed's routines, I'm sure you will benefit. But the average person will not become Ed Cohn doing Ed Cohn's routines, because there is only one Ed Cohn. Louis Simmons has become very, very popular in the last number of years, and his methods have certainly taken powerlifting by storm. If anybody rates as the most popular trainer in powerlifting right now, the West Side method as taught by Louis, I think certainly, without question, would be the number one way to go for many people. Can you benefit from it? Absolutely. If you're progressive and consistent in your training, you will benefit. Louis had many innovative ideas and many good ideas. Some I agree with, some I don't, but there's no doubt that he's been a tremendous and positive influence for many lifters in the sport. However, the average lifter, the typical lifter, has to focus on just a few things. Those few things are progression. No matter how you choose to approach your training, you need to progress. You need to do more every time you're in the gym or within a certain cycle. That means more reps or more weight on the bar. At some point, that progressive overload will result in stimulation that gives you more muscle and or more strength. And that's what the sport's about. So progression is number one. Consistency is important. No matter what your training philosophy, be it high volume or low volume, frequency that encompasses 4 days a week or 2 days a week, you must train consistently. You must be in the gym and do what you're supposed to do when you're supposed to do it. If you're injured, you cannot train. If you're injured, you cannot train consistently. If you're injured, you cannot train well consistently. So the consistency is very important, and there are factors that go into that. The average or typical lifter has to get enough rest and recovery, no matter what the volume. No matter what the frequency, there must be rest and recuperation time. That will vary from individual to individual, but because one of the greats or one of the gurus in the sport says that you should train X number of times a week, that may be too much or too little for your individual case. You must factor in the recovery factors, which include rest, nutrition, psychological downtime, and controlling the stress that comes with family, employment, and school situations. All that will affect your lifting. If those three main points are focused upon by the typical lifter, believe me, over time, if you're patient, it will result in progress. Last issue of Powerlifter Video, Dr. Salaria noted many, many important things that needed to be addressed by the typical lifter. And I'm talking specifically about stretching and about reducing the probability of injury. Most individual lifters will get hurt because they overtrain. Not undertrain, but overtrain. Again, we want you to enjoy your training. One of the things I've always espoused is variety in both approach and individual exercises that one will do. And certainly, there's much that is to be done, but keep a damper on your enthusiasm so that you don't do too much, so that you don't do too many things, so that you don't progress at a level that's so rapid that it produces injury or exposure to injury. An injured lifter cannot make progress. An injured lifter cannot train consistently. Stretching is vitally important. One of the things that Dr. Aria stressed was not only stretching and stretching consistently, but stretching all of the major joints. I think that as lifters, we think about the deadlift and we think about the squat, and we may be careful in doing flexibility work for the groin, for the hamstrings, and for the low back. However, it's just as important, if you're going to avoid long-term injury, to do flexibility work for the upper extremities. This would include working the wrist, the elbow, and the shoulder area. There is no doubt that in my practice, for as many low backs that I see and treat, if an individual is a power lifter, I will also see numbers of shoulder and or rotator cuff related injuries. This comes most often from overtraining in the bench press, or training too heavily in the bench press, or training too heavily too often in the bench press. So please, one of the things that I would stress is flexibility work for the shoulder area. I would also stress preventative rehabilitation work for the shoulder area so that the rotator cuff and the small supporting muscles of the upper back, of the chest area, and of the deltoid itself become stronger prior to experiencing an injury. There's nothing worse than being hurt and having to rehab the area. My suggestion is always to do the work so that you prevent the injury in the first place. Many powerlifters have told me that they don't like to use dumbbells, they don't like to do a lot of assistance work, unless it's things like incline presses, declines, things that are related to the three major lifts. However, it is important that one do the so-called light work, the so-called pretty boy work, at times during each yearly cycle, so that they can in fact avoid injury before it happens. As much as I enjoy doing overhead press work, which I think is a great assistance exercise for the bench press, and as much as I have done through the years, close grip bench press, decline bench press, and incline press, some of the things that we'll do with light weights, and here I'm holding 3 pounders, which may be enough for some strong individuals to begin with, we do use things like this. One of the things that is a standard in everyone's program is the lateral raise. And it's properly done by keeping the arms straight, coming out to the side, pausing, and slowly returning to the starting position. One of the things that a lot of bodybuilders will do is rotate the hand so that the dumbbell or the resistance is in this position. We don't want to do that. You do not want to internally rotate the shoulder. What you want to do is externally rotate it slightly, or if a pre-existing injury demands, rotate it externally considerably in order to reduce the pain and the impingement of the rotator cuff during the performance of the lateral raise. So properly done, if the camera will get this, we are externally rotating at the shoulder, we're pausing and then coming down. One of the things you see a lot of lifters do is bend the elbow, as well as internally rotate, and heave the weight up. And that will do very little. One of the things that we like to do, at least during certain times of the year, depending on the cycle, is recommend that the lifter do 2 sets of 15 repetitions in strict form with that. That'll very often be followed by a front raise. And what we'll do there is straddle and get in this position so that the low back is in a safe position. What we don't want to do is stand upright and then lean backwards to count the balance of the weight. That will increase the lordosis and the chance of impingement in the low back. So we'll get the low back in a safe position first. We'll lock the elbows, and again, it's a slow cadence. We're pausing in the fully contracted position, and we're returning slowly. Again, the hand is not being held this way with the dumbbell or the resistance, but with the thumb up. That again reduces rotation in the shoulder joint that could negatively affect the rotator cuff. And like lateral raise, we recommend two sets of 15 reps to be done twice a week during a phase where we're either trying to prevent injury and build the foundation or during a rehabilitation. Another thing that can be done with dumbbells or with a pulley setup is internal and external rotation. And I prefer to do these lying on the floor, which I don't think I'm going to do right now, but if you grab a pulley handle and externally rotate and bring it back slowly and externally rotate here, again, you'll give good work to the rotator cuff. If we realign ourselves and take the pulley handle here and then we do internal rotation with a slow return, that also is an effective movement. And again, I usually recommend two sets of 15 repetitions of both internal and external rotation if done with a pulley, or if it's done in this position while lying supine on the floor, it'll be 15 repetitions in each direction, two sets. That's done for preventative purposes and also as part of rehabilitation once it's needed, although that's done on an individual basis. We also suggest that at some point during the training year, direct bicep work is done. And again, a lot of lifters don't like to do direct bicep work. They think that the pulling movements give them enough work for the bicep. And I've been told it's not, quote unquote, manly to work your biceps. That's for bodybuilders when you're a power lifter. But again, we want to do a standard dumbbell curl with as much weight as can be handled in proper form. And that's done to a position of full contraction, squeezing that contraction, a controlled return, a full hang at the bottom, repeating it, squeezing, consciously squeezing the muscle that's working and contracting it and returning it. And again, there'll be two sets of 15 there. And the purpose of that is to protect the long head of the bicep tendon. Approximately 30% of all diagnosed shoulder injuries through the year statistically are found to be related to the long head of the bicep tendon. So that's a preventative measure. I know a lot of powerlifters like to look good and it also makes your arms look bigger, which is pretty cool. One of the things that helps to support the shoulder is the tricep muscle, and we also recommend that once or twice a year for approximately 4 to 6 weeks. Is a period of isolated direct tricep work. And a tricep push down on an overhead pulley is probably the best movement to use. Again, often relegated to the bodybuilding area, but again, a very effective exercise. It's been 41 years of lifting. It's been approximately 35 years in powerlifting. Certainly, I've made many, many friends and acquaintances that continue to be friends and acquaintances to this day from the sport. I think if you approach powerlifting as a means of self-expression, self-satisfaction, and self-discovery, it becomes much more rewarding than just trying to put numbers up. I think that powerlifting and many of the young people that we've been fortunate enough to work with through the Lakeview Youth Federation, through the Iron Island Gym, and through our garage here, has proven to be a means for individuals to move forward. It's certainly a great way to spend your time, to invest your time and energy. It benefits the body, it benefits the mind. Again, my emphasis would be on what happens psychologically, the satisfaction you can gain from it, and not putting so much pressure on oneself that it does not become enjoyable. Again, I'd like to thank Ralph Raiola for continuing the tradition of powerlifting at Iron Island Gym since the last 3 years. He's continued that with great beats. I'd like to thank one of my dogs for barking and making a racket. And I'd just like to thank Powerlifter Video Magazine for inviting me on once again. Thank you.